Well, you know, there was nothing the Victorians liked better than a ghost story. And so this is vintage Victorian, written by W.W. Jacobs, called Jerry Bundler. At the Boar's Head Inn in London, one evening there were five travelers and George, the waiter. They were sitting around in the coffee room talking, and as the light outside grew dimmer and dimmer, inside the only light now was the flickering of the fire in the fireplace. Talk turned to the supernatural. Malcolm said, "Well, I've never seen an apparition myself. I know people who have, though. Did you know that there is a ghost story attached to this very house?" Mr. Leake said, "Ah, I have traveled, I have stayed in this house many years. I never heard such a story." But the oldest of the travelers, the old gentleman, said, "My father knew that story well, and my father was a man of truth. He said that he actually saw Jerry Bundler." "Who was Jerry Bundler?" "A pickpocket, a thief, a highwayman. One night, about 80 years ago, he came and had supper in this very coffee room. And then he went upstairs to his bedroom. But he was being trailed by two policemen. And the policemen had the landlord take them up to Jerry Bundler's room. They rapped on the door, nobody answered. They tried to shove in the door, they couldn't. So one policeman stayed up at his room and the other one went down outside, around into the courtyard, the back of the house where Jerry's room was. And that policeman got a ladder. He climbed up the ladder up the side of that building till he got to the huge windowsill underneath Jerry Bundler's room, the window. And the policeman climbed inside. Now the folks below were watching. The next thing they heard was smashing of glass, and then that policeman plummeting down, down, and smashing on the stones below. And then they saw this pale face with sunken eyes peer out over that windowsill down toward that policeman. Some of the watchers stayed with that first policeman, and others went upstairs to help the other one push in the door. Heavy furniture had barricaded that door, so it took them a while, but when they finally got inside, there, hanging by the crossbeam of the canopy bed, was Jerry Bundler's dead body, hanged by his own neckerchief. It wasn't very long after that before Jerry Bundler started to haunt this house. My father, the last time he stayed here, was wakened in the middle of the night and saw the figure, the ghost of Jerry Bundler, letting himself down from the ceiling, reaching out to strangle him. Summers, one of the other travelers, said, "What room was your father staying in?" "I don't know. Why do you ask?" "Because I wouldn't stay in that room if I knew." "Oh, you don't need to worry about it. If you ask me, a ghost can't hurt you. My father said it was just the unpleasantness of the thing that bothered him. For all intents and purposes, Jerry Bundler's fingers might just as well have been cotton wool for all the harm they could have done him. Personally, I'd rather like to see a ghost. But for now, I'm going to go to bed. Good night, gentlemen." And the old gentleman went up to his room. Mr. Hurst, one of the other travelers, said, "Ah, that old humbug. I would like to give him a chance to prove how courageous he really is. How about I dress up like Jerry Bundler and scare him and let him prove it? Mr. Summers said, oh, Hurst, stop it. Don't even think about doing that. That would be a dangerous game to scare an old man. Nah, it'd just be a joke. I have plenty of costumes in my room from the play I'm in. I've got knee breeches, I got buckles, I got wigs and makeup. You give me a chance to go up and get changed, and I will come down and give you a preview of Jerry Bundler, Nocturnal Strangler. Summers said, it's very well to try to scare us, but you can't scare that old man. And Malcolm said, but it would be an interesting joke. I don't believe that you'd be able to scare me. In fact, I bet you couldn't scare me. Hurst said, done. I take that bet. You give me some time to get changed, I'll come down and do that thing. And the rest of you gentlemen can be the judges. And don't turn up the gas lamp while I'm gone. And Hurst left the room, went upstairs. A half hour later, Malcolm was checking his pocket watch, winding it, when suddenly George, who was the waiter and had been sent to get drinks, came stumbling into the room saying, he's here. He's here in the bar. Malcolm said, George, I do believe you're frightened. Well, you would be too, sir. Oh, it was terrible. It was a surprise of the thing. I didn't expect he'd be in the bar. I almost stepped on him and he was at the foot of the bar. I wouldn't have gone in if I'd known he was there. I don't think you would have either. What was that? All of them had heard a strangled cry coming from the stairs, and then footsteps running along the hall, and then the door sprang open. And there was a coughing, choking figure, quaking. Malcolm said, I do believe that's Mr. Hurst. George, light the gas lamp. George did, immediately. Why, Mr. Hurst, what in the world happened? Get yourself together, man. Oh, he said, it was terrible. Oh, it was horrible. I was on the stairs and this thing touched my shoulder. Oh, I turned around and it was disgusting. It was this evil little face, a little tiny head with all white, pale white, sunken eyes, this short cropped hair. Oh, George said, that's exactly what I saw. Malcolm said, how odd, you both saw the same thing. Who wants to go down to the bar with me and check it out? Everyone said, you go. We'll wait here. So Malcolm left the coffee room, made his way halfway down that hall toward the glass partition that went into the bar, and stopped, turned around, came back. Went back halfway, stopped, turned around, came back. On the third try, when he came back, the rest of the room said, well, did you see anything? He said, I don't know. I think I did, but I'm in such a state now. I could be making it up. Who knows what I think I saw? Mr. Leake said, you have all been talking so much about ghosts. You've made yourselves believe it. Just the same, said Mr. Leake, I need to lie down. I'm never going to play a game like that again. But listen, I don't think I can stay in my room alone. Mr. Summers, will you share my room with me tonight? I certainly will, as long as you agree that we can keep the gas lamp on full the whole night long. So Mr. Leake and Mr. Summers left, and the rest of them heard the door click at the top of the stairs. Malcolm looked around at Mr. Leake and and Mr. George, the last two in the room? He said, well, I guess that the bet is off between me and Mr. Hurst. He didn't scare me, but I never saw anybody look so scared as he did. Kind of poetic justice, don't you think? But I have to admit, I don't much want to go to bed in my room by myself. Mr. Leake, do you want to share the room with me tonight? Mr. Leake said, no thanks. I don't believe in ghosts. If anything comes in my room, I'll just shoot it. You can't do any harm to a ghost with a gun. Well, the noise will be company for me, and it'll bring the rest of the house running. If you need somebody to stay in your room with you, why don't you ask George? I'm sure he'll be happy to do it. George said, absolutely, sir, I will, sir. But I would be most obliged if you would come with me into the bar so I can turn down the gas in there. So Malcolm and George went into the bar. George turned off the gas uneventfully. They came back to the coffee room. They tried to ignore the smirk on Mr. Leake's face. Malcolm held the candle. George turned off the gas lamp. And right at the very moment that light went out, they heard something outside the door. And then a creak of the door. And into the room came this horrid little figure. White face, sunken eyes, short cropped hair. Looking around, bewildered. It reached up and untied the neckerchief from its neck, and its head lolled on its shoulder. And then it held that kerchief, that dirty rag, out in front of itself and moved toward Malcolm. And all at once, Malcolm's candle went out. There was a bang and a flash of light and the smell of gunpowder. And choking, and a thud. George lit a match. And they all looked. There was a figure on the floor. Malcolm tested it with his foot. It was firm. They lit the candle. Malcolm gave the candle to George. He got a handkerchief out of his pocket, wet it in a jug of water, and knelt down and began grimly to wipe the face. And Mr. Leake said, oh, and put his hands over his face to block out the sight. Because there on the floor was the dead face of actor Mr. Hurst. Thank you. So the Victorians have it, huh?